Thanks and welcome. I have to say to excuse before the session, not because the session is rather introductory when it comes to Kotlin, not because I'm talking about testing again, like every year here. No, I will trial live coding, so most of the time we will just code Kotlin tests, and the first rule of speaking is don't do live coding, so we definitely will fail, right? So what's the whole thing about? Anyone here was at Google I/O? That's a few. And the rest probably knows. I mean, when this moment came where they showed like Kotlin on stage, I like goosebumps. I was using Kotlin before, and it was like an amazing moment, right? I mean, Kotlin is there. Kotlin is official. I mean, we used it before, a lot of us. But now it was there. And all of us were like this, right? We are Android developers. We are partying on the streets, finally, at least in our heads. I mean, we're a bit introverted, right? But Kotlin was great. We were super happy, at least during I/O. Then we came home, talked to our boss, and it was more like this. No Kotlin in production. And all developers like this. But then, okay, maybe we went too far. But maybe there's a backdoor. No one cares about the tests, right? I mean, actually, if you know me, I would say like the test code is like the most important code that you have. That's what Uncle Bob saying, and I kind of agree. Might be more important than your production code. But and we know what, when we talk to our stakeholders, they don't care about the tests, right? They don't care if you write tests at all. So we can use this. And actually, tests are a safe place for experiments. Use that new library in your test. Play around with that. Use that new language in your test. So the party goes more like this instead of on the streets. It's more Berlin style anyway, right? So let's test in Kotlin. So, and that's all the presentation I will do. Let's look at code, because I think it's much more important. So what I will do is I prepared a couple of Java tests. Java unit tests, as we all know them. And what I will try to do is convert them to Kotlin and see if there are things we can actually make better in Kotlin, where we can use like the power that Kotlin has in our tests. So, sorry, I didn't have enough time to set this up here. So for a moment, exit the presentation mode. Just have the project here, and then we can go in again. Okay. So I don't even will show you what this app, it's not even an app, is about. We'll just look at the test, because that's how it's supposed to be. Look at the test, the tests are your documentation. And let's try to understand what it tests here, and then we will convert them. So it looks like I have a class, an important class doing something. I'm creating an instance of this. And then there's a test called handles null arguments. I guess it's passing null in, and I guess nothing should happen here. So no exception. That's how the test looks to me. If you've been to my Barcom talk last year, it was like mostly how I write tests. So there is no private final there because it's like noise. It is in a way in your tests. I don't like that. I call the test on the class normally tested. Most of it's pretty straightforward. The only thing I would change here, even in Java, is get rid of this testing. Don't start your test with test, right? And if you know me, I would probably do something like this. I think that's read better in the test report at least. So let's at least run the test once. Let me know it's actually working. So default JUnit test, OK, it's fine. And it looks pretty nice in the test report of the underscores, although normally I would not use underscores in my method names. But in tests, I like it. But that's all we can do in Java, right? I mean, it's super simple, right? So what we should do is let's make this a Kotlin test, right? So Android Studio, convert to Kotlin. First thing you have to do. Looks pretty much the same as before. There's some small cleanup we will do. OK, let's make this a val. A val is like an immutable thing. That's pretty much it. Is there anything we can now change, which wasn't possible in Java? Actually, I told you, like, you know, this method. I like the underscores, right, because it reads nice in a test report. But actually, what I want is this, right? Write like a real sentence. That's not possible in Java. It's possible in Kotlin. We can write it like this. And it actually runs. That's a valid method name. And it looks much nicer on a test report. And in the end, it's what you see in your Jenkins, right? The test report. Small warning here. this will not work when you have an Android project. So you cannot write your espresso tests right now with methods like this. But just 2 days ago, Jake Walton tweeted, it's one of the things he wants to fix in the DEX format. It's a problem of the DEX format. So hopefully we can use this soon. Because for me, this is a really nice way to write your method names. But let's look at a real test, right? Something that is a bit better than this. So let's see, what else? Let's go to the project. Look at another test. OK, we have an important class checking something test. Let's see what that does. Should throw if empty. So I guess I have some class that I'm instantiating here. And if I pass empty, it will throw an illegal argument exception. Rather simple test as well, as we are still in the beginning of the talk. So nothing to do here. Let's just convert that thing. Convert to Kotlin. So don't be afraid of Kotlin. It looks pretty much the same as before, right? That's the nice thing. But there's one thing that always annoyed me a bit when it came to that kind of testing in JUnit. Because we are used to write our test in like 3 steps. Arrange, act, assert. Given, when, then. Let's look at this test. Given, when, then. That's kind of annoying, right? Because you read all those tests in the same order. But the ones throwing exception, you have to have the last statement basically at the top. That sucks. I don't like this. So let's keep it like this, and then we can do something with this pure Kotlin as it is. We can say, you know, this fails with an illegal argument exception. I think I have to do it like this. Yeah. Done. It's not perfect yet, as it's still not correct order, but it's much closer. So this method is actually the one that will throw the exception. I like this much more. And actually, with the one that we had before, let's just run it in the meantime. So before, any of those method calls, actually even a preparation, could have thrown an illegal argument exception. You didn't, maybe you didn't even run the method you wanted to test. With this syntax, we are getting closer. And I will show you later an example how we can make it even better. But let's go with pure Kotlin for now. That was too simple. Let's look at another example. I have an awesome parser, which has an awesome parser test. So I'm instantiating this class. I have some pre-prepared JSON here that's like just pasted in here in a Java file. And there's a test should parse. And yeah, we call a parse method with this text. We get a map back of string and integers. Oh, that was the clicker. Don't worry, I don't need it. and then it checks basically, hey, this booking thing he wants to retrieve from this map, and this should be this number. Okay, whatever this is, that's what this test does. It's short, but it's a bit ugly, so let's start by converting into Kotlin. And again, some cleanup. The internal is because I didn't have the private final, but I don't like in test. One thing you might notice that I now have a compiler error. So to convert to Kotlin, sometimes you have to do some afterwork. Why is this? Before you actually said parsed.get booking. Kotlin has this nice syntax here, it looks like an array. But the problem is a map.get returns a null. I didn't say it didn't handle null here. So you say, hey, this can be null, and you're directly using it. It's a nice feature in Kotlin, right? It's like null safe. So you have to explicitly tell him, hey, that's fine. So normally in your code, you don't want this ugly thing, and test is totally fine. I totally expect that this will be non-null, else the test is supposed to fail. So it's totally fine using this here. But it still looks ugly. Let's start at this one. This is an ugly bastard, I think. What we actually want is something like this. So there is a JSON, and it starts with channel. And then it has some, maybe we left it here. There's something called booking, and there's a value, and there's another thing, whatever GTG is. Someone here works for Groupon, he knows what this is, because I copied the test from there. And close it. That looks much nicer, right? Let's see if it still runs. So what I actually did here is, so test once, should pass. When you use those three apostrophes in Kotlin, it says, whatever comes next, take it as it is. There is no masking of apostrophes or something. There's no need for backslash R, backslash N, and all these ugly things that we put in. Because what normally happens in Java when we do like those kind of tests, as we're creating such a mess, we take this JSON and put it to a file next to the test, right? Like one test file and one JSON file. The problem is you're not really seeing what you're actually testing. So I like to keep them close to my tests. All of a sudden, I can do this. I can inline this even in a method. So that looks already much nicer. What else do we have here as ugliness? I mean, this looks really hard to read. I don't know, pass and then a two int. Let's make this better. Wouldn't it be nicer when I could say parsed dot, I don't know, maybe the parsed dot get for the booking already returns me an int. Let's do this. There's a nice feature, and for me it's like the most important, like my favorite Kotlin feature. It's called an extension function. Basically, you add a function to something, to a class, that wasn't there before. And we'll use Megalord in this talk with this. So I create a function that is actually, remember the parse thing was a map. Another thing that is, by the way, gone, if you haven't realized. It was this map string to integer thing. The nice thing of Kotlin is this looks like a dynamic type language, right? It didn't even specify a type. That's a cool thing of Kotlin. It is totally statically typed. This is totally has a fixed type. But the compiler knows what this is. It sees what it is. Doesn't have to tell him. So actually behind this is a map. So it was a map of string and int, right? String, int. And I'm adding a method to that map. And I call it getInt. But definitely not a part of map, right? Sorry. Whoop. OK. And what I want to do, actually, so I want to take the map, so this. I want to take, actually, we can use the same syntax that he uses, so we can just, like, something like this, right? But I don't want to do the to int. I guess we need a key. So we grab the key and do the to int. Maybe I should have copied it. But, up to int, OK. And now, we can use it like this. Okay, now it's a method call. Could even use the syntax as it was. So this looks already better. So we can hide this somewhere in the bottom of our text or in a test util. So I say parse.getInt. As you can see, if you're scared by this extension function thing, don't be. It doesn't change map. When you look at the bytecode of this, this actually is just a static method with two parameters. One is a map and one is a string. But Kotlin allows you to use this as if it would be part of that that object, the map. But you can see it with the italic. That's actually a static call. Maybe we can, let's go a bit crazy. And wouldn't it be cool to just tell the text to parse himself? Let's do this. So the text is a string, right? Although we didn't specify, it looks like a string. So I add parse int, give him a key that I want to grab. And all we have to call is, OK, it's like a tested thing. We still need tested. Dot parse this as it's the string. And then we call this other method that we just created with the key. That's what wasn't hard. And actually, now we can remove all of this. And we say, you know, JSON text dot, I call it parse int. Looks crazy, right? I mean, doesn't make any sense as you can't even see the tested anymore. But what I wanted to show you is how you can clean up your test code and get everything a bit out of the way. And you can decide what's the visibility of this. You can even move them out and move them here or move them somewhere else. Yeah. So I come a bit later to more to what you can do with extension functions. But right now, see them as something to clean up your test. Let's look at another test. Again, back to Java. So there's a class called RadioState. OK. And it has a method called isSignalStrongEnough, a static method, and to give him a map. And it's a map of those kind of things. It's like a signal type. So there's like edge, I don't know, 90% or 90 whatever, and Wi-Fi 0. So that's what the test sets up. It says, should calculate the strength. And not even well named, I would say. Could be a bit better. But OK, let's convert this. Let's don't talk about Java part, right? Let's forget about Java. So again, it looks pretty similar in the beginning. So same three lines. But there's a lot of cleanup we can do in those three lines. except changing the method name, right? So I don't like this part, right? All we want to do is set up a map. Wouldn't it be nice to write something like, you know, I need a map. Yeah, give him a type of, actually, it's an edge, and the value is 90. And I need another parameter, which is Wi-Fi, and it's 0, and that's it. Looks much nicer, right? But we're not done yet. Actually, we don't need to tell the compiler the type. It sees what the type is, because we're giving two arguments. Also, I mean, that you could have done this in Java. I think you should definitely import those. Let's get rid of all this noise here. So, and now we have a map. Oop, sorry. That looks actually readable. You could even inline this here if you want to. But let's do this. So this looks already better, I think. Well, I could live with this for now. Yeah, let's go on. I have a test for this radio state class. So it seems like this radio state has like some predefinitions, like on and off. I guess there's also an on, yeah. So radio state all on, off, sorry. And then I'm testing two things. Hey, cellular should be off and Wi-Fi should be off. So the test call should be off. Let's convert this. Still looks the same, right? The only thing you see that the parentheses are gone. Are they called parentheses in English? Because you can use getters and setters, and so everything that is like the Java bean naming convention as properties, which is pretty nice and reads just better. When looking at the test and you think about like what is like a clean test, maybe one thing you could think of, I have two asserts there, and shouldn't we suppose only have one assert in a test? Actually, there was a, if you know like the Uncle Bob videos, there's a separate section about that, and he said, no, it's about asserting one thing. And we need multiple asserts here, but we are asserting the same thing, that there are no connectivity, right? So it's totally fine to have two assert statements on paper. I still don't like it. Wouldn't it be nice to write assert false tested dot, I don't know, is connected. So now you could go there and create is connected, right? But then we would change a class just for the test. That's something we should never do. If you have to manipulate it, your class, you did something wrong. So maybe we can't even control this class. Maybe it's like a system class, the radio state thing. I don't know. But we are in Kotlin. So we can fix this. So let's create an extension function. Function, it's a radio state, so part of radio state, is connected. And yeah, what we have to do, we have to check cellular and is Wi-Fi. So actually, no, that's wrong, right? We need the OR. Wait, where's the OR? No. Changing too often between two keyboards, sorry about that. Anyone remember where the OR was on an English keyboard? Alt Shift 7? Good tip. So what we now can do is get rid of this. And the test looks much nicer. And we added something that we didn't all without touching the radio state. Yeah, I think I'll like this. Should we do something else here? Yeah, maybe. Wouldn't it be nicer if we could already modify this, if we don't have to use this weird assert thing to say tested dot assert not connected? That would be cool. Let's do it. And actually, you don't have to write them yourself. You can also ask the Android Studio or the IntelliJ to create you this. I mean, I just will remove the private here, but it's a radio state. Assert not connected, and all I want to do is actually, yeah, it's this, right? I don't see the other extension function because I put it there. Perfect, maybe make it like this. I want to save lines, I'm lazy. Okay, and now I have an assert, which is actually part of the test set. So it might sound silly in the beginning, but think about it. You can do Normally, your test is a bit more complex, right? You're creating something, and then you're preparing it. So you do tested.set something, that set this. This could be all known one extension function. And then you run, do an assert directly on the object and a test, which just reads very well. And in the end, tests are all about readability. Tests are your specification. You have to understand the tests. So get all the noise out of the way. So just an idea. Maybe think about asserts that are very specific to the object and the test. But they are just staying in this test. No one else sees them. You can make them even private if you don't want to get confused. Let's look at another thing, another test. I create this thing. I don't even know if it's an invalid English word, a greeter. It's a class that greets you. Right. I just made up this word, maybe. It has two tests. Let's look at the first one. So it says, I create this and call greet with the word droidcon. It returns, hello droidcon. Actually, it's a hello world, I would say. But there's another method. And I could ask for basically all the greetings it knows. And there should be the German word hello in there. OK, these are two tests. Test asserting something in a list and asserting a string. Super simple. Let's make it Kotlin. I guess nothing changed. Looks pretty much the same as before. OK. And I didn't do it all the time, but sometimes I want to do this because I can't stand ugly method names. OK, what could we do here? Maybe one thing that normally you wouldn't use in your tests is the normal JUnit assert equals, right? We all are used to either like the Hamcrest assertions that we know from Espresso, or I was a big fan of the fest assertions, which are also pretty cool in Java. Why is that? Why don't we like this one? Because we always forget which one is the expected and which one is the actual value. So let's check, actually use it correctly. But maybe you want to have a custom assertion method. Hey, this was wrong. Now this method gets really confusing. Come on. So that's why the JUnit asserts normally no one uses. But instead of introducing something from a Java world, let's look what is there in Kotlin. Is there something? And actually there is. So I added the library called Cluent. So let's see what this can do. Because actually, what do I want to test here, right? I want to check that greeting, so the thing that returns, should equal two, depends on what you like. What was it, hello droidcon? I think so. That looks much nicer. And wouldn't it be nicer if I should even could rather take this? It would be, and we can do this. We in Kotlin. So this leaks pretty well. We could even maybe inline this. Let's see what it looks like. Yeah, looks good. So this looks like now we are getting into the world of the more like DSL looking tests, right? I mean, there are frameworks that could do this in Java, where we, not in Java, but in languages when we think about like stuff like Cucumber and so. Like in the BDD world, that this. So let's continue, maybe change a second one in the same way, and then look if we can even improve that. So what do you want to check? Actually, we want to check if this list, see, I didn't specify the list again, which is nice, should contain hello. Looks good, but I don't like this one. I also want to put it like this. That looks good. Let's run it and then explain you how it actually works. Greeter test. See, test report looks nice, the spaces, and even all the method calls looks pretty nice. So let's inline this. It's one line. Perfect test is one line. So I like how this looks like. You might wonder, what is the syntax? Now we left like the world that we know of Java, right? What are those spaces? Actually, let me quickly revert this to the one that isn't. Because let's first understand this one. So what's happening here is it's actually calling a method called shouldContain with an argument hello. That's the same thing. How is this possible? There's one thing you have to do to make this possible. You have to declare, and then I'll jump into the method, you have to declare this method infix. If you know Groovy, they have the same concept. So when you look at your Gradle file, which is Groovy, they use the same concept of the infix notation. And actually, when you look at Kotlin script, which is like a new way to write Gradle files, It's all based on this. So it allows you to leave out those parentheses formatted call and to leave out the dot. So why am I telling you this? Not only because this looks nicer and you should use this. No, actually, you could use it yourself. Actually, all your tests are very specific to your context, right? So you could write your own DSL kind of thing that makes totally use of your context. So there's still like a method call here. Maybe we can get rid of like this old style method call. Wouldn't it be nice to say something like, let's say, calling tested.greet with droidcon should equal hello droid. That would be nice, right, if we can write something like this. Now this doesn't look like Kotlin or Java or anything. It's like it's a verbal description of a test. It's a specification. That's what a test should be. So let's make this possible. So what we need is a method called calling. Okay. What does this method? It's a function. Sorry, method. So what does this method need? An argument. It has to take a method. The problem is we can't write it like this because we have to defer the method invocation until we have this parameter. So we need to have it more like this. So give it like a lambda. So we want to call the tested.greet. So this method will take a lambda, and then we have to continue. So add parameter to the method call. So I already sees this method. And now he adds this ugly bastard here. Let's get rid first of the name argument. I don't care for now about this. So it basically says, hey, you know, you get a lambda that has a function that takes a string and returns a string. That's great. There are better ways to write this, but let's keep going with this, what the compiler suggests us. So now the next part. So we have the first part already green. Nice, right? Now we need to make the with possible. So what do we need to return? Actually, the same method, because we have to cannot call the method before we have this argument. So actually, all we have to do is return the same function. By the way, in Kotlin, you don't have to type return if you didn't notice so far. The last thing is always the thing you return. OK, now we need a method called with. OK, let's do this. I need an infix method called with. What does it take? It takes a string, right? What is it, an argument? No, wait, does it take a string? It doesn't take. It has to be, let's see. Yeah, of course, it has to take what we just returned, right? So we still have to work on this. Sorry, let me start again. Sorry, take a deep breath. OK, now I know my mistake. So we have this with here. So actually, we think about how this works. We have to call something on something the word with. OK, so this needs to be an extension function. So and it takes an extension function on this thing here. OK, so let's remove, doesn't have it. Don't need a name here. It's an extension function on this function thing called with. We have to tell them that this is an infix function. It takes a string, as I said, right? Argument, string. And it will return a string, I would think, because we have to assert on it with and should equal. See? I mean, we didn't implement the method yet, but the whole line is already done. So all we have to do is actually implement this method. You don't have to specify the return type in Kotlin if it's clear for the compiler. So let's just tell him. What do we have to do? So on this, which is this lambda, so we first have to get the real function because we are passing a lambda. And then we have to invoke the function and passing a string, which is the argument. That's it. Actually, I can write it like this. So just invoke this method. That's all it does. And let's run this whole thing. It might look super weird for you, but these are the things you only write once. And it's green. We wrote calling tested.greet with droidcon should equal hello droidcon. Reads super nice. And normally you don't read this, but you always read this on your test. So just want to give you an idea. You don't should write tests like this, but give an idea how easy it is to write with a bit of infix, a bit of extension function, this kind of things. This, by the way, how the should equal also works. It's not only an infix method. It's an extension function on any. So anything could be in front of here, right? So it just adds to any, which is basically the object of Kotlin. We didn't talk about one thing at all, which is mocking. By the way, how are we in time? Because I don't see the time. Perfect. Okay, that's a bit bigger test, because normally in a larger test you need mocks. So let's walk over this in Java. So it's about a fragment. So let's talk about Android, right? So it's a very important fragment. And it has a mock, which is a bundle. So you use the mock annotation. So that it works, I need to call Mockito annotations in mocks. Now the mock is filled in a setup method. Then I program the mock, so when it call getString with any time of a string, it will return test. And then I wrote two tests, or maybe someone wrote those tests, reads from bundle and writes to bundle. The first one calls onCreate. It's the onCreate method on a fragment, the normal one, gives in the bundle, which is a mock. And then just make sure, actually, did he ask for a getString with this key, with the secret key one? You might wonder why I don't use constants here. You should not use constants in your tests, because make sure if someone changes something, that the test breaks. Because if you change something, the test should break. So it might be good to duplicate those. And then it actually verifies even the state. It should be the test thing that we programmed. Looks simple. Let's look at the writing. Use this Mockito feature called inOrder. With this one, he calls onSaveInstance with the bundle. So, and then he verified that actually in this order, with putString first and then putInt, the bundle is used. Actually, when you look at it, it's probably not needed, because a bundle is a key value thing, so you don't need an order. But if this would be a parsable, then it would be important that the right order is written, right? If you remember, like last year, I don't use Roboelectric, so I actually write code like this if I have to write manual bundling, parceling code, which I try to avoid by using other frameworks. Okay, then the end has like a verify no more interaction. So pretty simple test. What should we do? Let's convert this test. Kotlin. He warns me I might have to clean up a bit. Okay, let's see what he created with this. So he kept this mock, but he didn't know about bundle. So he saw his bundle wasn't initialized, so he thinks, so this might be null. So Kotlin, you have to say specify, it's a nullable type, and he sets it to null. Actually, what he didn't know about what mock annotation is, and that I will make sure that before I use the mock, that it's actually filled. So I can tell him this, you know, this is actually a late init. And I can remove this. So I will tell him, trust me, it will be initialized before used. Two version late init and lazy. And the same, this is actually just a while. Okay. Then I can remove this, because now he knows that this is no. Looks ugly, I think. But let's clean it up step by step. So why do we use this mock annotation? Because in Java, we had to specify when we would do it manually. Type variable equals mock, and then in parentheses, the type again. So everything you always have to say twice, right? That's why people add the mock annotation, because you just have to type the type once. In Kotlin, actually, we don't have this. So I would actually ask you to not use the Mockito annotation stuff, because you're also spreading things in the initializer block and the setup method. So let's only use one. So let's get rid of this and just initialize the mock manually, the way we would do it in Java. So we say, actually, this is a mock class. And so now we would have the Java way, right? It's there twice, but we can actually remove this, because the compiler sees what it is. One thing we noticed, when you use Mockito, it gets a bit uglier because of the class.java, which sometimes happens when you use like tools that develop for Java. But we will solve this in a minute. But let's go for now. So in the setup method, all that is there is the when statement, right? Wouldn't it be nicer to move it close to where we actually create a mock? I think we should do this. Let's get rid of the whole setup block. So we can use the thing called apply. So you can use call those methods called apply, run, let, with. I think there's another one. You can call them on any method. And basically what they do is they allow you to do something in the context of the class that you're calling. So and the difference is what is actually the context and what is the result. So apply gives me as a control the bundle, so that this is now actually the bundle. So I can do, I can put this in here and say, remove this. So when get string, then return test. So next thing that looks ugly, so this was ugly in Java, in Kotlin. This looks also ugly. Why is this? When is a protected keyword in Kotlin. So looks ugly, let's try to get rid of this. And I mean, we are Kotlin. Do we really have to tell him that this is any string? There's only one version that gets string. So let's solve this. I added another thing to my project, which is called Kotlin Mockito. Now you might think, no, I will use Mockito as it is. Actually, it's not a new Mockito. It's just a bit of sprinkles, like syntactical sugar over Mockito. So I will change this. So what this one allows is, for example, use a generic. I have to tell him that this is a different mock. It's not a Mockito one anymore. Come on, see it. Where does it suggest me? I did something wrong here. See, never do live coding. By the way, let's remove this one. I think he's confused with the mock. So I won't use mock. And there's one from Kluent, which is basically the same one. So Kluent also uses Kotlin Mockito. But I want to use the Kotlin Mockito one, and I wonder why he doesn't show me then. But OK, let's go with this. I think that's the same thing anyway. Thank you. That was the trick, yes. That's why pair programming is a cool thing, because someone will tell you your mistake. It still doesn't say me the Kotlin Mockito one. And now we have it, yes. So. Okay, now I can write it like this. So get rid of this class.java. We'll hurry up a bit because we don't have much time. Bring this back. So it also solves this when thing. So there's a whenever, which is basically the same thing. Bring the dot apply back. Okay. Whenever, yes. Okay, there's more that we can do. As I said, we can use get rid of the any string. It's any. I mean, the compiler knows what it is. Don't tell him. Tell them what this verify thing is. Get rid of this. So it's really, really easy now. There's one more thing. We can even get rid of the apply because we are now in the Kotlin world. I can just pass this and write it even better. I can say, you know, on. So whenever someone is called, whoop, disable this. Get string, do return, test. So we are going back to this world of the infix and the extension function. So this looks much nicer. I will just hurry because we are running out of time and clean up also the second test for us. You know, when you ever see something like this in Kotlin, you can make this better because you don't have to repeat yourself. So you can use this dot apply, for example, even in the Mockito world now. And then get rid of this. And then we don't need to verify anymore. And the code gets more and more readable. Just for this Kotlin Mockito, a few niceties before we finish up. So the tested method, the tested fragment, had like a set adapter, because it might be a list of fragment or something. One thing you can write in that Kotlin does for you, if you have a set and get, as I told you, that follows the Java B notation, you can directly use them as properties. And then you can write something like this. This is actually calling the method set adapter and passes in a mock. And you can do it even the other way around. You can say, I want to verify adapter, tested dot adapter. I call, and normally I would say it like this, right? That I call, test adapter. Nobody would say verify set adapter with a mock, but I can now say, so this line tests that the method set adapter will be called with any kind of argument. He knows that this will be an adapter. So again, no type here, no type here. So with stuff like this, your test gets really, really nice. And just close, let's close this. Oh, everything is gone. OK. So we use Kotlin Mockito. We use Kluent. And tests are a great way to learn Kotlin, but also Kotlin brings a lot to your tests. One thing you have to keep in mind, so this is great to get your team up to speed, but it's just a start. At some point, you want to move on. You want to add Kotlin in production. But by then, all your team knows Kotlin. So you have another argument for your boss. I want to say thank you. If you wonder why I have this old school MTV shirt, I'm working for a company that owns MTV. And And you can stay in this room, please, because we are continuing with Kotlin tests, because two of my colleagues came from Poland to get a bit more in-depth, because I was just the introduction here. So thanks, and not sure if you have time for questions.
Thanks, Danny. Yes, there are some minutes left for questions. Are there any?